Do subscribe to Ikeda channel and press bell icon to get updates about latest engineering, HSE and IIT JEE main and advanced videos.
Hello friends, now we are going to talk about a particular topic, that is Born-Haber cycle, in which we are going to talk about how does it plays a very significant role in calculating the lattice energy of a particular crystal. So let us talk about it. It is very essential to know that what would be the lattice energy of a particular crystal when we are talking about an ionic solid. But this ionic solid's lattice energy cannot be calculated directly. So for that we have to take a sequence of the reactions, and because of the Hess law, and we could apply the Hess law, and from that we could determine what would be the lattice energy of a particular crystal, that is of a particular ionic solid. So now, for talking about that thing, the Born-Haber cycle has been played a very vital role. These are the two scientists that had made this kind of process while combining all the sequence reaction that takes place during a formation of a ionic solid. So what are those kind of sequence of reactions? Let us talk about it in a very deep analysis. So it says that the sequence of the reactions, which involves the formation of one mole of a ionic compound in its standard state from its constituent elements in their standard state, is called as Born-Haber cycle. Means we know that a crystal, or we could say as ionic compound, is formed by the constituent particles like atoms, molecules or ions. But during this formation, it should be in standard state. That is, the formation of a compound should be in a standard state, as well as the compounds that we are taking, or the constituent elements that we are taking. For example, it would be a atom, ion or a molecule, they all should be in a standard state, and because of which we could be it would be very much easy to calculate what would be the lattice energy of a particular ionic solid. So to make it understand more in a better way, so I have an example for that, so that we could learn it in a better way without any kind of confusion. So let me give an example, that is when we have to calculate the lattice energy of a particular crystal like NaCl. So Born-Haber cycle for the formation of crystalline NaCl solid can be followed in a various sequences that we are going to do now. But before that, we should know that the formation of one mole of crystalline NaCl solid can be represented as, that is sodium, that is which is present in a solid state, plus half the moles of Cl2, which is nothing but gaseous, that is chlorine, that will give us NaCl. But while formation of NaCl, the energy that has been liberated, that will be -411 kilojoule. And as we could see, this enthalpy, that is the change in enthalpy, that we could see that the change in enthalpy is at standard thing, and this F stands for the formation. So this is the standard condition that we have, and in this -411 kilojoule of the heat is, or the energy is being expelled during this process. So, but formation of this process, that is formation of NaCl molecules, it doesn't take place directly when you bring Na and there is sodium, which is present in solid state, and you introduce chlorine. It takes several steps also, and what are those steps? Let us talk about that also. So it states that the formation of NaCl involves the following sequence of reaction. There are many sequence of reaction that takes place, which would lead us to make the formation of NaCl as a solid or as an ionic compound. So talking about the first one is sublimation of sodium will takes place if we have to form the NaCl molecule. So the first one is, what we are going to do is we are going to sublimize the Na metal. But Na metal is basically solid. And since we have to make it undergo a sublimation process, that is we have to convert the sodium which is present in solid to directly a sodium which will be present in a gaseous state. So means basically we are changing the phase of the solid, phase of that matter from solid to gaseous state. And in this case, a delta H, that is the heat of sublimation that we have, it will be equals to 109 kilojoule. That is 109 kilojoule of energy should be supplied to the solid sodium so as to convert into a gaseous sodium atom. So this is the amount of energy that has been that would be required to convert this process. So now talking about the next one, that is once the gas gaseous atom of sodium has been produced, so the thing is we have to ionize it so as to make it a sodium ion. We have to convert the sodium atom into a sodium ion. So this kind of process is basically known as ionization of one mole of sodium atoms. So for that, basically one sodium gas which is present in a gaseous state, and what we are going to do is we are now removing the electron. And to remove an electron from an atom is basically known as ionization process, and the energy that is required to remove the electron from the atom is basically known as ionization enthalpy. And that kind of energy can also be introduced in the form of or can be said as delta H equals to 496 kilojoule, or this could be represented as delta H of ion, that means ionization energy, which is equals to 496 kilojoule. Means 496 kilojoule of energy has been required so as to remove an electron from the gaseous sodium atom. So these are the two one of the two steps that we have involved so as to form the NaCl molecule, that is a NaCl solid. So these are the two steps. Now let us talk about the other one, that is, so that one was earlier for the sodium. So now we are going to talk about the chlorine atom also, because chlorine is also been involved in the formation of NaCl. So in this case, dissociation of half moles of Cl2 into atoms, because as we know that chlorine has been present in a gaseous state as well as it is a biomolecular substance or a gaseous thing. And in this thing, what we are going to do is we are going to divide it, and we are going to divide it into atoms because this has been present in a molecular state. So therefore, half moles of Cl2 which is present in gaseous state, we have to convert into atomic state of Cl gas. So for that thing, the delta H atom, this is known as atomization, that we have, that is the enthalpy of atomization, that is required is 122 kilojoule of energy. So 122 kilojoule of energy has been sufficient so as to separate this two atoms and to form a monoatom of Cl, that is which is present in the gaseous state. But this is not the last thing that we have to do, because we have converted Na to which was present in solid to Na which is present in gaseous state, and again that gaseous state has been converted into an ionic state. So in this case also, we have already got the gaseous state of the chlorine, but we have to convert that into ionic state so that Na plus and Cl minus, the both will combine to form the NaCl. So in this case, what will happen is addition of one mole of electron to one mole of gaseous Cl atom is necessary. So that means we are making the chlorine atom, which is basically neutral in this case, we are making the chlorine atom to gain electrons so as to get a negative charge. So this kind of gaining the electron of an atom is basically known as electron gain enthalpy. So in that case, Cl which is present in a gaseous state, it will acquire electron so as to form Cl minus ion, which is also present in a gaseous state. So in this case, the delta H, that is the heat of the heat produced during the electron gain enthalpy, it will be, that is, it is represented by delta H of Eg, that is electron gain enthalpy, which is equals to, that is, minus 348 kilojoule. That means minus 348 kilojoule. This indicates what? This indicates that this much energy has been liberated if one electron has been accepted by a chlorine atom. So if one electron is being accepted by a chlorine atom so as to form a chlorine ion, so then minus 348 kilojoule of energy has been lost during that process. And after all, and once we have got Na plus ions in the second step, that is in the step number B, and in step number D we have got Cl minus ion. Now we could relate those two things, as you could see right now. So now it would be very much easy to form NaCl as a solid, that is formation of one mole of solid of NaCl by combining the gaseous ions. So the gaseous ion that we have is Na plus and Cl minus ions. So this Na plus and Cl minus ions will combine with each other and to form NaCl, which is nothing but the a solid compound. So during this process, the energy is been released, or how much energy is been released, that is been denoted by delta H, and this delta H is means the heat of reaction or the enthalpy of this reaction. But this will be equals to delta H of L. And what is this delta H? This is nothing but the crystal lattice enthalpy. So this will give us the information that how much energy does a NaCl molecule have, or how much energy does the crystal of NaCl has. So for calculating what would be the delta H of this NaCl, in this case, during the formation of NaCl, so we have, what we are going to do is we are going to apply Hess law. So the thing is, now we are going to apply the Hess law, and in this case, what we are going to see is, we will add all those equations that we had, that is A, B, C, D, and E. So in this case, what we are going to learn is, or what we have got to know is, Na, which was present in a solid state. This is the overall reaction that we are doing. So Na, which was been present in a solid state, plus half of the Cl to half moles of the Cl2 molecules that was been present in a gaseous state. And overall, what we have got it, we have got NaCl as a solid. So this is the overall reaction that we have, but this reaction has been made or has been concluded by using the various steps that were been involved, that is from step number A to step number E. So by combining this all equations, we are now capable of finding what would be the lattice energy of that particular NaCl molecule or of that particular NaCl ionic which has been present in a solid state. So therefore, the delta H will be what? The delta H will be the total energy that we have will add by using the Hess law. So if we have added all those energy, then what we have got it as 379 kilojoule plus the delta H of L, that is the lattice energy of the NaCl that we have. So in this case, what we have got the overall delta H as 379 kilojoule plus delta H of L. So now in this case, but we know that the delta H, that is for standard enthalpy of formation of NaCl, we have delta H is equals to minus 411 kilojoule. So this value we are going to substitute here. So this is the overall Hess law that we have applied in that thing. So therefore, minus 411 kilojoules will be equals to, this is the value of minus 411 kilojoule, which will be equal to 379 kilojoule plus delta H of L. That is the lattice energy of that particular NaCl molecule. So therefore, the delta H of L is equals to minus 411 kilojoule minus 379 kilojoule, which makes us to know that the value of the delta H, that is the lattice energy of the NaCl molecule, is basically minus 790 kilojoules. So this indicates that this much energy is being required so as to bring back the NaCl and Cl minus ions to form NaCl as a solid. So this is the thing that we have got to know. So because of the Born-Haber cycle, it is very much easy to calculate what would be the lattice energy of a particular ionic compound. So that because the lattice energy cannot be calculated directly, so we have taken the help of Hess law as well as the Born-Haber cycle that have made a very good conclusion so as to indicate or so as to determine what will be the lattice energy of that particular substance. So let me give you a small synopsis of this, that what we have did today in the Born-Haber cycle, and this is because of the help of the diagram. So this is the diagram that we have. So initially, what we have got to know that the Na that is present in solid state plus half of the Cl2 molecule, it will have produced minus 411 kilojoule of energy so as to convert so as to become NaCl, which is present in a solid state. But this can be calculated, so as to calculate what will be the lattice energy of that. So what we have did is we have made it in a sequence, in a several sequence of reactions, in which what we have did, we have sublimized the sodium, that is we have converted the sodium solid to sodium gas, in which 109 kilojoule of energy was being required. And further on thing that 496 kilojoule of energy was being required to ionize it or to remove the electron from the sodium atom. And further thing, we have atomized that Cl2 molecule and we have converted into an atoms so as to form a Cl here, as you could see, so as to get 122 kilojoule of energy has been required in that process. And overall, the next further thing that we have is the electron gain enthalpy. Once the chlorine has been made, so to gain electron, so we have minus 348 kilojoule of energy has been lost. So as this Na, so as this Cl has been converted into Cl minus, and this Na that has been produced here, it has been combined with this thing to form NaCl. And this NaCl will again combine with each other so as to form NaCl, and this clearly indicates that minus 790 kilojoule of energy is being liberated if Na and Cl will combine with each other. So this gives a clear indication that we could find out the lattice energy of a particular substance, and in this case we are talking about NaCl. So this is how this was very much easy to understand, I hope. So thank you friends for watching this video. I hope you have liked this video and you are going to do this sharing with your friends too. And yes, don't forget to subscribe to Ekeda channel. Thank you so much.